once a prophet, was a good chaver of mine. Never understood a single word he said, but we helped him to drink his yin. And we always have some mighty fine yin. Simon Sim, Chadli Olam, Kol Ayiladim now. Simcha to the dagim in the deep blue sea, Simcha to you and me.
Yeah. Welcome to the Haftarah Plethora video podcast, where we might not bring joy to the world, but we do talk about prophets like Jeremiah, Isaiah, and Ezekiel. But today we talk about a prophet who was more than a prophet, Samuel, who was literally a kingmaker and perhaps one of the most important leaders in the entire Tanakh. And this week's Haftarah tells us much about the challenge that Samuel faced and about his character as we reach the critical point of the transformation of Israelite society from to being unified under the rule of a king. So Rick, do you think we're up to the challenge of doing justice to the story of this great Jewish leader?
I don't know. I don't know if it requires anything more than letting the trope fly, because we've got a great selection of trope to chant this week.
Well, that's why our viewers tune in each week.
That, and maybe for the hackneyed frog humor.
Fair enough. I'm sure that Norm has a chuckle waiting at the end of this week's Haftarah Plethora. Anyways, I'm Larry Herman, sipping some very fine wine and talking Haftarah to my good chaver, Rick Muller, a.k.a. the King of Cantillation. And speaking of transitions, here are this week's picks of my granddaughter, Millie Rose, a.k.a. Amalia Verrid, not to be confused with our beloved dog, Billy. Millie had a great week, smiling at her great-grandfather, Sonny, draining a bottle from her Zadie.
That would be you.
Yep, that'd be me. And starting to explore and manipulate her world. Amazing how quickly all this happens. But back to our Haftarah. Korah. The Parsha is all about how a rebellion goes bad and the question of legitimate leadership. In the Haftarah, the people get their way when they rebel against Samuel and demand that he appoint a king.
Right. But Samuel isn't as keen as the people on appointing a king, and perhaps takes it a bit personally as a rejection of his leadership. In any case, he inaugurates the monarchy of Saul, but from another Haftorah, Zachor, which we read right before Purim, we know that it doesn't end so well.
That's true. But this week's Haftorah focuses on Samuel's speech to the people at Saul's inauguration. Remember, Saul has just made his bones by leading the Israelite armies against the Ammonites, rescuing the tribes of Reuben and Gad. And even though Samuel tried earlier to dissuade the people from choosing monarchy over traditional leadership by shoftim or judges, our Haftarah starts with Samuel inviting the people to inaugurate the monarchy.
True, but look at the difference in trope between Samuel's call and the people's response. In the first case, Samuel's call to the people is chanted with pedestrian trope. Lechu v'necha ha-gilgal un'chadesham amlucha, just a simple tipcha et nachta mercha tipcha sof pasuk. Come, let us go to Gilgal and there inaugurate the monarchy.
That was a corny pun alert there. Pedestrian trope on let's go.
Yes.
I like that. But you are right, because the next verse, which describes the response of the people, is filled with pyro-trope-ics.
Pyro-trope-ics.
Yeah, musical fireworks. Rick, chant the beginning of the next verse, which describes the people's response.
Right. Vayelchu cholam ha-gilgal, vayamlichu sham et Shaul.
You see what I mean?
Yep.
Tu kadmava azlaz, rivia, atalisha ketana. The trope enthusiastically described the response. So all the people went to Gilgal, and there at Gilgal, they declared Saul king.
I see what you mean.
The rest of Samuel's speech is a diatribe against the people, against their demand for a king, against their lack of faithfulness to their God, and an apologia for Samuel's own authority as the leading prophet and judge. It's a rather grudging and embittered speech, as if he's saying, okay, here's your king. But what did I ever do to deserve your lack of gratitude, you ingrates? Adonai has been good to you, even when you didn't deserve it. And if you don't behave, woe unto you and unto your king.
Yeah, but by the end of the Haftorah, Samuel is a little more positive. The people acknowledge that they did wrong in verse 19, and Samuel concludes in verses 20 through 22 with an optimistic promise that if the people serve God for the sake of his great name, the Lord will never abandon his people, seeing that the Lord undertook to make you his people in the first place.
And that's where we end, at least for the Haftarah. But the chapter actually continues for three more verses, concluding with a warning when Samuel tells the people, for if you persist in your wrongdoing, both you and your king shall be swept away. As Robert Alter explains, Samuel deftly upstages the king whom he has just helped the people to confirm in office. He is clearly telling the people that they will still need him to act on their behalf, which indeed ends up being true, as Saul's madness eventually leads to his downfall.
Politics and leadership are complicated, but chanting Haftorah isn't. How about if we start?
Good idea. Let's divide the reading into four parts and examine the trope in each as you chant. We'll start with the end of chapter 11, verses 14 and 15, and the beginning of chapter 12, verses 1 through 5. In those verses, Samuel invites the people to anoint King Saul, but then immediately challenges the people for their choice, which the people sheepishly acknowledge. Then in verses 6 through 10 of chapter 12, Samuel reminds the people that God has been good to them, but they have behaved badly, which the people once again acknowledge. Then in verses 11 through 19, Samuel again criticizes the people for demanding a king rather than obeying God, and warns them that if they don't heed God, they and their king are doomed. The people plead for Samuel to intercede on their behalf. And finally, in verses 20 through 22, Samuel tells the people not to worry, that God will not forsake them. Happy ending, at least for now.
Sounds great. Our text is found in Eitz Chaim on page 877. And thanks to our technical wizard, you can follow along on the text on the screen.
But first, let's discuss what we have in the first section of selection of the text.
Okay, we already discussed the contrast between the trope and the first two verses.
We did. But I think if we look at the second verse, the Ata Hinei HaMelech, where we've got a Ger Shaim on the Va'ata, it kind of suggests irony or maybe even sarcasm when Samuel says, but now here's the king.
Yes. Then there'll be more on the Va'atas that are coming up later.
Right. But that's a key word throughout the Haftarah. And now more sarcasm in verse three of chapter 12 with the Hinini, which we often see that. Hinini Anu Vi Neged Adonai Ve Neged Mishicho.
Yes. And the Hinini echoes Abraham's Hinini, and I think it was Yaakov, here I am, and Moses, here I am. So Samuel is comparing himself to the great leaders of the past. Here I was to lead you, but you want a different leader. So he goes through and says that he didn't take an ox, he didn't take an ass.
The connection to the Parsha, right? Just like Moses is saying to Korah and the followers of Korah, what did I ever do to you? Never stole your ass.
Right.
In that same verse with very dramatic trope, we have Shmuel saying the same thing. Maybe you want to just read that little bit, et shor.
Yeah, et shor has the Talisha Kitana, Milakachti, who did I take? So the Milakachti repeats, and then Vachamor, the Dargah is dramatic again, and then Milakachti again. So it's poetry, it's intensity. He's being real, like a lawyer before the jury.
Exactly. And his summation is dramatic because we have again another Kadma Va'azla and Vayomer Alehem.
Yes.
And he spoke to them.
And then aid, the witness. God is the witness before you. And then that sentence ends again with witness. And aid is always a charged word to witness what God is doing, to witness crimes, things like that.
All right, Rick. Well, how about if we start off with the bracha? I think you announced the page number. We're on page 877 of Eitz Chaim, or yes, reading along on the screen. The bracha, and then we'll start the chanting.
Okay. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kidshanu b'mitzvotav, v'tzivanu la'asok b'divrei Torah.
Amen.
Vayomer Shmuel el ha'am, lechu v'nelcha ha'gilgal, unchadei sham ha'mlucha, vayelchu chol ha'am, ha'gilgal. Vayam lichu sham et Shaul, lifnei Adonai ba'gilgal. Vayizbechu sham zvachim shlamim lifnei Adonai. Vayismach sham Shaul v'chol anshei Yisrael ad meod. Vayomer Shmuel el kol Yisrael, hinei shamati v'kolchem lechol asher amartem li v'amlich alechem melech ve'atah hinei hamelech mitalech lifnechem v'ani zakanti v'asavti uvanai inam irchem v'ani italachti lifnechem min urai ad hayom hazeh, hineni anuvi, neged Adonai, v'neged Meshicho, et shor, milakachti, v'chamor, milakachti, v'et mi yashakti, et mi ratzoti, umiad mi lakafti chofer ve'alim einai bo ve'ashiv lachem v'yohomru lo ashaktanu v'lo ratzotanu v'lo lakafta miad ish me'uma v'yomra lehem eid Adonai bachem, ve'ed meshicho hayom hazeh, ki lo metzatem, beyadi me'uma, vayomer eid.
Very nice. So Rick, in these next five verses, what have you got for us?
So 6 through 10, again, we have the Ve'ata, the now. So it's a signpost along the way. Now you wanted this, so now this is going to happen. And that repeats again. So that's the verse 7. There's a Yativ on Et. Kol Tzidkot Adonai, all the kindnesses, all the righteousnesses that God did for you. And still you misbehaved.
And we mentioned last time, and I'm seeing more and more, that those yativs are almost always on these two-letter words.
Yes, to dramatize even the smallest words and the phrases. And then the only pazer of the story, so the rarest trope, is in verse 9, in Vayimkor Otam. So the tradition, or Aharon ben Asher and Shlomo ben Buya, the last Masoretes who codified all the trope, they decided to put the pazer there on God handing over them, the previous generation, to the hands of Sisera, the bad guy from the Philistines. So the emphasis here is that God is in charge of everything. And when you do bad, you're punished. When you're good, you're rewarded. So that's what I can read from the Pazer there on Otam.
And Rick, I got to tell you, I'm going to take issue with the JPS translation on verse 10.
Okay.
So if you look at their translation for the part of the verse, it goes, Ve'ata hatzilenu miyad oyvenu v'na'avdecha. The Ve'ata, the JPS translates as, oh, but clearly this should be again a now, as yes. In the people saying, now save us.
Yes.
It's a transition. They're saying, okay, we did badly, but now save us.
Uh-huh. Yes. So I like that translation better. And it again, it picks up on the viatas that Samuel was using in other places.
And at least I can refer to Robert Alter supporting me, because he does translates that viata as a now.
Yeah, very good.
All right.
So 6 through 10.
There you go.
Vayomer Shmuel el ha'am Adonai asher asah et Moshe v'et Aharon v'asher he'elah et avotechem me'eretz Mitzrayim v'ata ityatzu v'ishavta itchem lifnei Adonai et kol tzidkot Adonai asher asah itchem ve'et avotechem kasher ba Yaakov Mitzrayim v'yizaku avotechem el Adonai v'yishlach Adonai et Moshe ve'et Aharon v'yotziu et avotechem mimitzrayim v'yoshivum v'makom hazeh v'yishkechu et Adonai Eloheihem v'yimkor otam v'yad Sisra tzar tzva chatzor uv'yad plishtim uv'yad melech Moab v'yilachamu bam v'yizaku el Adonai v'yomru chatanu ki azavnu et Adonai v'na'avod et ha'balim v'et ha'shtarot v'ata hatzilenu miyad oyvenu v'na'avdecha.
Excellent. Very good. All right. Okay. Moving
so the
on.
Next section, yes, 11 to 19. So the trope that stand out to me are Ki Nachash, the new bad guy, Nachash, king of the Ammonites.
A snaky king, huh?
Yes. And I like the Ammon, the Zarka on top of Ammon, looks like a snake anyway. So the name Nachash is serpent, and the trope looks like a serpent. So I think that was chosen for a reason.
A trope pun.
Yes, on the part of Aharon ben Asher, I would imagine.
Rick, and then, I have a question for you on verse 12.
Yes.
So I noticed that we've got a Zarkaf Katan on the word Li for me.
Vatomer Li, Vatomru Li, yes, goes together.
Right. And followed by a Zarkaf Gadol on the word Lo.
Yes.
Tell you the truth, I don't know, but I don't, that seems pretty rare to me. I don't remember having a Zarkaf Katan followed by a Zarkaf Gadol.
Yeah. I can't put my finger on whether it's a big deal, but from now on, we'll watch for those. But yeah, it's amusing that first you have a Zakev Katon and Zakev Gadol.
All right.
And the word is emphasized low. No, we must have a king, is what Samuel is saying, the people said. And then again, verse 13, there's another Be'atah. So now here's your king, Hine HaMelech. And again in 13, we have Natan Adonai with a Dargah and a Tavir, which we just did last week. We just had it twice with Rachav, hearing that God gave the land of Canaan to the Israelites, and the report from the spies to Joshua, it's the same. So by coincidence or by design, in the very next Haftorah, we have it again, and it's going to appear in verse 18 again. But I hear the echo, I hear the trope there on Natan.
So you're saying in verse 18, the V'yitain Adonai is similar trope or the same trope as the Natan Adonai.
Yes, which is from last week also. Right. And then up to the Haita Yad Adonai, in between those two in verse 15, there's another Dargah Tavir. It kind of links them. And the hand of God will come down on you if you don't do well.
So Rick, I got one in verse 19.
Yeah.
I want to run by you at the end of this section. Here we have the people, the Yomru, Kol Ha'am. And again, that's very dramatic. Just as the people were really dramatic in their reaction to Samuel saying, okay, you can have your king. And they got up and they ran to Gilgal.
Yes.
And here they're enthusiastically speaking to Shmuel.
Yes. He palel, they say, pray for us. Uh-huh.
Right. And these guys are really motivated.
Yeah, well, they want to move forward. They want to have a stable government and fight the bad guys. So this is what they think is going to save them. So, yeah. Okay, and then at the end of it all, at the end of 19, right? We have, I think Samuel makes a pun here with Lishol Lanu Melech, Lishol, to ask. And I see Shaul's name in there. It could have been written any number of ways. Give us a latate lanu, or any other verbs. But he shows lishol lanu to get the sha'ul and the sha'ol, I think. But
right.
I could be wrong.
I think you're on the money. He's saying, I'm reading the translation, the JPS translation. He's saying, then you will take thought and realize what a wicked thing you did in the sight of Adonai, when you asked for a king, but the Sha'ol could be what you did in the sight of Adonai when you made Saul or chose Saul for your king. Yeah. So I think you're right. It is a pun.
Okay.
All right.
So go on.
Let's read.
11 to 19. Vayishlach Adonai. Et Yerubba'al v'et Bedan v'et Yiftach v'et Shmuel v'yatzel echem miyad oyvechem misaviv v'teshvu betach v'tiru ki nachash melech b'nei Amon ba'alechem. Vatomru li lo ki melech im loch aleinu varuna elohechem malkechem ve'ata hine. Sorry, hine ha-melech goes together. Asher b'fartem anish eltem. Behine Natan Adonai Alechem Melech Im Tiru et Adonai Bavatem Oto Ushmatem Kolo Velo Tamru et Bi Adonai Beitem Gamatem Begama Melech Asher malach alechem, afar Adonai Elohechem, v'imlo tishmeu bekol Adonai, umritem epi Adonai, v'haita yad Adonai, bachem uva avotechem. Gamata ityatzvu hu uru et hadavar hagadol hazeh. Asher Adonai oseh leinechem. Halok tzirchitim hayom. Ekra el Adonai v'yitein kolot umatar. Ur'u ur'u. Kira'achem rabbah asher asitem b'nei Adonai. Lish'olachem melech. Lish'ol, Shaul is there too. Vayikra Shmuel el Adonai. Vayitein Adonai. Kolot umatar vayomahu. Vayira kol ha'am me'od. Et Adonai v'et Shmuel. Vayomru kol ha'am el Shmuel. Ipalel be'ar avadecha el Adonai Elohecha be'al namut ki yasafnu al kochatoteinu ra'a lish'olanu melech.
Rick, I want to point one more thing out from verse 17. It's not quite alliteration, but it's really interesting. After the Etnachta, ud'u ure'u, right? So yes. You will, and the way it's translated is, you will take thought and you will realize, or you will think about and you will see.
Yes, d'u, da, you should know, da'a, right. Yeah, yodea, uh-huh.
Right, but it's a nice little phrase there.
Yeah, turn of phrase, uh-huh.
And says so much about the Torah and the entire Tanakh. It's poetry even when it's written as prose.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
All right. Well, we're turning to the final last three sentences.
Yes. And I wanted to say that in verse 20, the Al Tira'u, don't be afraid. It's in a nice calm kind of trope. It's not dramatic. They could have chosen any kind of trope there, but I think Samuel is trying to bring the people down from scaring them so much in those couple of words, don't be afraid. And then towards the end of that verse 20, I see b'chol levavchem, which echoes in my head, the v'ahavta, all your strength, all your might, all your heart.
You think it's an allusion to the Shema?
Yeah.
Va'avadatem et Adonai b'chol levavchem. Yeah, I can hear the Shema in that.
Okay. And then you picked up when we talked about it before, the two keys in verse 22.
Ah, ha, ha, ha. The keys to verse 22.
Yes. the translation, again, we thought it was kind of upside down. That the English starts for the sake of his great name, but it really starts with Kilo Yitosh Adonai, that God won't abandon you.
Will never abandon you, never.
Yes, yes. And then key, the second one has a Yativ, that God has decided, he resolved, he undertook to make you his people. And the words there at the end are a little convoluted, but that's the message there.
Yeah, I did wonder about that. Ho'il Adonai la'asot etchem lo le'am. But maybe it's just normal Hebrew grammar, but la'asot etchem, to make you lo, to him, to God, like le'am.
Yeah.
So, it's almost like the la'am is being made into a verb, to be his people.
Yeah, could be.
In any case, I'm probably wrong about that. So let's chant the last three verses and wrap it up.
Uh-huh. Vayomer Shmuel el ha'am al tira'u atehem asitem e kol hara'a hazot ach al tasuru me'acharei Adonai v'avatem et Adonai v'chol levavchem v'lo tasuru ki acharei hatohu asher lo yo'ilu v'lo yatzilu ki tohu heima ki lo yito shadunai et amo ba'avur shmo ha'gadol ki ho'il Adonai la'asot echem lo le'am.
Wonderful. And I noticed at the beginning of that last pasuk, we actually have the word amo, and at the end it's le'am. But we'll save that for our grammarian, or we'll talk to Rabbi Klickfeld about that and see what he has to say.
Yes.
In any case, as always, thanks to our technical advisor, the master of fonts, and the chief wise croaker, Normgar. And don't forget to write us your thoughts and comments. Our email addresses are below. And if you like our Zoomcast, please forward this link to your friends and to your family. We wish you all a Shabbat Shalom and Happy Tammuz. See you next week.
Bye-bye.